Greetings, greetings, fellow Whogazers, and welcome back to Doctor Who Literature, the podcast taking you through the world of the target novelizations and publication order. My name is Jason, and I'm your host on this journey, this very long journey. We have a packed episode for you this week, so let's briefly get our preliminaries out of the way for my friends across the pond, which is a little more than half of you according to my podcast stats. There is a new king and a new prime minister. Queen Elizabeth II passed away a few days before I record this, and we have a new king, or I should say you guys have a new king, Charles III, and a prime minister, Liz Truss. Condolences and congratulations in whichever respective order you believe those should be parceled out. This week, we are talking about Doctor Who and the Time Warrior, the Terrance Dicks novelization. We have Conrad Westmaas back as a guest. Conrad has laid down a fabulous reading from the book, which I will play a little bit later after my conversation with him. But I want to talk about the book first, and then we'll get to Conrad, and then I'll finish my breakdown of the book on the far side of that. Doctor Who and the Time Warrior, written by Terrance Dicks and Robert Holmes. Spying credit to Terrance Dicks, televised as the Time Warrior, teleplay by Robert Holmes, televised in December 1973 and January 1974, the very first Doctor Who serial aired in my lifetime. Book published June 1978. His spaceship, crippled in an interstellar battle, the Sontaran warrior, Linx, is forced to crash land on Earth. He arrives in the Middle Ages, a time too primitive to provide the technology he needs to repair his ship. Allying himself with the local robber chief, Linx uses his powers to borrow, quote-unquote, scientists and equipment from 20th century Earth. Doctor Who tracks down the missing scientists and journeys into the past to save them. But can he defeat the ruthless Linx and his savage human allies before the course of human history is changed forever? Interior. Jason's dining room / office / recording studio. Day. Jason. Okay, so, yippee. Another Terrance Dicks book. This should be a short, quick read, and an easy 10-minute essay to record for the podcast. Let's, as the man says, get to it. Voiceover. Linx was his name. He was a microsecond from obliteration. A million miles out, in the sterile black infinity, his starship's sensors had warned him of the asteroid belt. His heavy, triple-digit hand moved just once, and the starship, silent as a whisper in the night, curved in towards the very center of the belt. It was a tired, suicidal gamble. Insert record scratch sound here. Jason. That doesn't sound like Terrance Dicks. Some of you have pointed out that here I am, 42 episodes into this podcast, not counting bonus episodes and specials, and I have yet to mention David J. Howe's definitive The Target book. I do that for two reasons. One, this is a podcast with a somewhat narrow audience, and my market research department tells me that most people who listen already have that book, and you don't need me to tell you what you already know. Two, Howe's book is so informative and so well-researched that it would be lazy and sloppy for me to merely do a podcast where all I'm doing is reading out snippets from his book. Plus, I try to focus more on the writing style and the prose rather than the behind-the-scenes. However, in this instance, having been at this show for nearly a year now, and coming up to this really interesting moment where I'm reading Terrance Dicks' prose that doesn't sound anything like Terrance Dicks, it's time to read a little bit from the Howe book, which you guys have read already, but it's important. And I'm going to be either paraphrasing or taking quotes from pages 48 through 50. Please buy the book if you don't have it already. David writes that when talking about the novelizations, Terrance Dicks is nostalgic. He agrees that his working method on the books changed as time went on. Quote, at first it was a good challenge. I'd never written a novel before, and so I tended to invent and fill out more stuff in the early books. Then, as the schedule grew more hectic and picked up pace, then it got to the stage where I was doing roughly one book a month, it became more a technical exercise in taking a script and turning it into a book. And this is more quoting from Terrance Dicks. Quote, I'm always kind of defensive about people thinking it's a piece of cake. You get two things from a script. You get what people do and what they say. You don't get what they look like, what they wear, what the weather is like, how they feel, what they're thinking. Any of the visual aspects that are provided on television by the costume and makeup departments, and indeed by the actors themselves. All these things you have to recreate on the page, so the author has a lot of work to do in filling all this in. Terrance also says that certainly as time went on, I added less and tried to put everything that was in the script into the book. And this is the most important part. David J. Howe writes that in the case of The Time Warrior, Dix had persuaded Robert Holmes, the original scriptwriter, to tackle the novelization. With no sign of the manuscript, W.H. Allen, that's the publisher, asked Terrance to chase it up, and he discovered that Holmes was having difficulties but still wanted to write the book. Then after another long gap, three pages were sent by Holmes to Terrance with "You finish it" written on the top. And I'll point out that that anecdote also appears on at least a couple of the Doctor Who DVDs, special features, and maybe one of the audio commentaries or two. Back to the book. Terrance was very impressed with the three pages, and often said that he wished he could write like that. But at only three pages a year, it would be hard to make a living. Dix used Holmes' work as the prologue to the eventual novel, and as Holmes requested, wrote the remainder of the book himself. That's again paraphrased from pages 48 through 50 of David J. Howe's The Target book from Telos Publishing in 2007, and according to the copyright page, is itself adapted from material first published in DWM, issues 291 through 301. Turning back to my copy of The Time Warrior, I have the fourth edition, published in 1983, cover art by Roy Knipe, his first work for the Target range. And coincidentally, Knipe's bio also appears at pages 48 and 49 of the Howe book. This cover is just gorgeous, gorgeous. This is a photorealistic Sontaran standing in space, a blue star field, with the distinctive Sontaran golf ball spaceship hovering behind him from the waist up, and including behind the logos and title and author credit. This book is long. 138 pages, which is the longest book that Terrance has written in years. The prologue, that's the Robert Holmes material, is 10 pages long. So if you subtract that, this is still a long Terrance book, but not as long as his novelizations of, say, Claws of Axos, or Dalek Invasion of Earth, or The Talons of Wang Chiang. And remembering what I said last week in episode 41 about Jerry Davis, devoting what was probably a record 50 pages to episode 1 of Tomb of the Cybermen, here, the part one cliffhanger to The Time Warrior falls on page 60. 60! With the book starting at page 7, that's 54 pages of text devoted to just 25 minutes of television. Already, this book fascinates me more than any Target book has fascinated me in months, and I'm only three paragraphs in. In the very last paragraph of the prologue, there is the line, "Sontarans rarely smiled, except at the death throes of an enemy." Now, if memory serves me right, Terrance is going to reuse this line in the Invasion of Time novelization, which we'll come to here in another 3 or 4 months. That's the first sentence of the last paragraph of the 10-page prologue. The rest of it is something that Terrance hasn't written before, a taut techno-thriller. We learn almost everything there is to learn about Sontaran civilization with these 10 Robert Holmes-written pages. How recruits into the Sontaran Space Force undergo partial cyborgization, if that's a word, in order to fly their ships, what Sontarans look like, where they come from, Sontara here, and not, as the new series later establishes, Sontar. Ha! Their war with the Rutan, battle strategies. What's clever about this prologue is two things. One, it's everything that makes Holmes' TV scripts so wonderful. The realistic throwaway details that suggest entire unseen histories behind all the characters. And second, is something the Target books haven't given us yet to date. That techno-thriller with battle strategies and evasive maneuvers. that might well be an early Star Wars influence showing through on the target line, or it could be drawn from Holmes' own extensive wartime experiences. The Time Warrior on TV was made as part of Season 10, written somewhat reluctantly by Holmes from an idea by Terrance Dicks, a story set in the Middle Ages. Time Warrior was, I think, on my original top 10 list, as I posted to RecArt's Doctor Who in the early 1990s. I'm still very fond of the Time Warrior, and it's the story that I covered in the original Outside In volume. That's from ATB Publishing in 2012. Although when the next Outside In volume revisits the classic series, I'll be covering a different story for that book. What needs to be said before I talk to Conrad and before I read through the rest of the Time Warrior is that here you have a classic story written by an author who didn't want to write it, partially novelized by said author until he gave up, and then completed by the script editor who commissioned the story in the first place. So that means Terrance has to do two things here, or three. First, adapt the story within the limits of the typical target word and page count. Second, he has to adapt the story on short notice, since he's pinch-hitting for the original intended writer. And three, he has to adapt his style to fit the style of Holmes' prologue. So here's another embarrassing young Jason confession. When I was a kid, I had trouble finishing this book. I had trouble getting past the prologue. At ages 11 and 12, I was not into military techno-thrillers, and I struggled with books where the Doctor didn't show up. Here, astonishingly late in the day, on page 27, which is later than the Doctor entered some of the new adventure novels of the 1990s, and the NAs were famous for having many books where the Doctor didn't show up for ages and ages. And by the way, that caused Lance Parkin to make sure that Doctor was the very first word of his debut novel, Just War. So while I've always loved Time Warrior on TV, this wasn't one of my favorite books. And to this point, here we are in 2022, I'm not positive that I read it more than three times. So, what we'll do now is we'll go to my guest interview with Conrad Westmaas, Conrad making his second appearance on the show. Then I'm going to play this incredible reading, this performance, really, that Conrad has generously volunteered to do for me, and that's adapted from the prologue, of course. And then, after that, I will be breaking down the 17 chapters that Terrance spent adapting this story. That is a record length for Terrance to date. Let's get to it. And I am very happy to be joined for the second time by somebody who describes himself as a way-faced ninny, but is more likely a long-shank rascal with a mighty nose. Conrad, welcome back to the program.
What a lovely way to be described. Thank you so much. It's really lovely to be back again.
So, Conrad, you spontaneously reached out to me earlier in the week, and you offered to do a recording of an excerpt from the novelization, which I'm going to play a little bit later on during the broadcast, but I will say that I listened to it and I am just blown away by the quality of the recording and the musical selection that you added on to the very end of the excerpt, and I cannot wait for my audience to hear that.
The devil's in the detail. Yeah, I just thought, why not challenge myself? And the thing about, well, yeah, it's a very important part of this book, I think. So I just thought, yeah, let's give it a bit of, put it in the spotlight a bit, because it's a wonderful part of this book.
I will be spending a lot of time talking about that prologue, which was written by the one and only, the incomparable Robert Holmes, even though he does not get author credit in the book. And just reading the book this week, The Time Warrior, I am often enthused by the books that I read because there are so many good ones, especially this early on in the line. But I was particularly jazzed over this book, and I kept finding new things that I'd never seen in the book before that bear discussion. And I'll have that conversation a little bit later on in the program. But for you, where does Time Warrior rank in terms of your favorite novelizations?
I mean, incredibly highly. I think it's, as I think I said in the last podcast, like I'm not the most well-read guest you've got on here, but as a story itself, it's incredibly high up. It's so clever. I think Robert Holmes having his cake and eating it by having historical with sort of the sci-fi elements and putting those two together by characterizing them in Irongron and Linx and pitting those two up against each other is just delicious. And I think every part of this, it really feels like a good classic. It's got I was thinking, in a way, if you were going to show somebody or get somebody to read a Doctor Who story for the first time, this would be a good place to do it. It's got everything you need in Doctor Who, plus a new companion. And yeah, I think that the prologue does really add something very, very special to this book. But you've got Terrance Dicks doing, well, you know, we'll talk about it, but like doing really extraordinary work. And I think sometimes it's easy to sort of think, oh, Terrance Dicks, he does a very faithful adaptation. And he does, but it's so skillful. The things he, you know, that script editing eye at work, the things he adds in, the things he leaves out, the little details and touches and flourishes are really not to be underestimated. And there's tons in his book, so I can't wait to dig in. How about you?
I was surprised by how much he changed. I mean, it's a very faithful adaptation in terms of scenes and in terms of dialogue. He changes a couple of words here or there for narrative flow, and I'll give a more exhausting accounting of that. I should say exhausting. It's a Freudian slip. I'll give a more exhaustive accounting of that a little bit later on during the program. But by and large, 95% of what you see on the screen is preserved here in the book. And there's one short scene between Irongron and Bloodaxe that he leaves out in part four. It's a funny scene, but it's short and it has no plot utility. But he adds a couple of scenes for narrative clarity. He changes the fate of one character, and he makes a couple of stunning complications to the script, not to spoil what I'll talk about later on. But having read the book years before, it wasn't stuff that I'd ever really noticed or paid attention to before. But now that I'm reading it page by page while looking at the episode transcript, he took some very serious liberties. And it's impressive because you have Robert Holmes writing those first 10 pages in a very specific Robert Holmesian prose style, which is not like anything in the novelizations we've seen before. You can almost feel Terrance Dicks changing his prose style to match Robert Holmes and challenging himself. And for a guy who had written 8 books in 11 months the year before, challenging himself and coming up with this is, it's like running a marathon the day after running a marathon. It's just amazing what he did.
Yeah.
So before we get too deeper into the Time Warrior, let's backtrack and talk about you. What other podcasts have you been doing lately, and where else can we hear you?
Oh, so recently I have, let me just think. I've got Trap 1 coming up. I think that's probably the next one podcast I'm going to be on, which is going to be reviewing the new animation of The Abominable Snowmen, which I saw at the BFI the other week. And we've got a very nice team lined up for that, so I think that's going to be really fun. I've also recorded something for Flight Through Entirety,
Who
are currently at the in the 50th anniversary season, and they're putting together, without giving too much away, they're putting together quite a program of podcasts for the 50th anniversary week, and I have found myself within all of that. So yeah, at some point later this year I'll be popping up on that. But yeah, so yes, I'll be I'm always part of the Trap One gang and a little bit of Flight Through Entirety and anyone who'll have me. So yeah, that's what I've been up to.
And, of course, this is your second and hopefully not your final appearance on Doctor Who Literature. And I do want to point out that you've been part of the audio annuals gang on Trap One, which are always must-listen episodes.
Now, that is enormously fun. I think we've only done two, but somehow, yes, myself, Denise, Cy, and Mark, it starts with the Canine Company audio annual review, which we did at Christmas, which was incredibly good fun. We did another one, and Mark has already got us in for doing another one at this Christmas, so listen out for that again.
And, of course, you first came to my attention as part of the expanded Joe Ford podcast universe. Have you been doing any hamstering lately?
I haven't done any hamstering for a very long time, but it's going from strength to strength, and that family is growing and growing, so who knows?
Reproducing like hamsters.
Yes, exactly. Exactly so.
So let's talk a little bit about Abominable Snowmen. I covered that on this podcast, I believe, back in episode 10, and I'm a very big fan of the book. It's one of Terrance's earlier works, and he's changing a lot, and he's adding a ton of atmosphere, and he's enlivening a TV production beyond what we see from the surviving video. When I watched Abominable Snowmen as part of my pilgrimage, and that's about a year and a half now, I was so disappointed in it, watching it in sequence, especially because the whitewashing of the Tibetan characters and some of the makeup and acting choices really do not play well 55 years later, watching, you know, in the early 2020s from a production made in the mid-1960s. And some of that was industry standard at the time, and it was not the production team going out of their way to offend, but times change and standards change and what's acceptable changes. And I just found that much worse than I had remembered. And where the book, the Terrance Dicks book, is very respective of Tibetan culture, as you would expect from the guy who was co-showrunner along with the practicing Buddhist Barry Letts, I thought that the TV script was coming from a much less sympathetic place, and the Tibetan monks were presented as antagonists rather than as enlightened men who were deserving of a fair hearing. So I was trepidatious when I heard that they were going to be coming out with the animated version of Abominable Snowmen. And when it was announced they were ending the animated line, the BBC America line, with that story, I wondered if it wasn't because somebody high up saw the story and said, wait a minute, we can't do this. So I was curious. So I've only seen bits of the animation from the trailer, but I believe, and I'm very happy for this, I believe they have recast the actors visually for the animation.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. And I was very lucky that some of the Blu-ray team were on stage sort of giving interviews, and I think they were asked about that, or that came up. And Gary Russell, who co-directed it, was very quick to say that the moment that question came up, he was like, we are absolutely not only casting Tibetan, you know, sort of people who typically would be in the monastery, but like actual people from different countries around who also would have been in there. So there's still diversity within that. It's not like they're all Tibetan people, because that wouldn't have been who'd been in monasteries. So there's people from all different countries there. But that's, he said that was never, you know, that was instantly, he said, this isn't going to be a question. We're going to absolutely cast, in inverted commas, cast this properly. So while the story is still remaining, that is, that's very clearly addressed.
I mean, Gary Russell has been doing phenomenal work with those animated DVDs between Fury from the Deep and Galaxy 4. He is just elevating those stories. I prefer the black and white to the color animation because I'm a traditionalist and I want to see the stories as close to their original form as they were. These are stories that were directed by really radical young directors, mostly in their late 20s. And if we were to get the surviving video, as we did with Galaxy 4, when that missing episode was recovered, we'd be very impressed with how the episodes look for their day. But if you're going to do a Blu-ray release and you're going to animate it, why not go all out with color and scope? And just the endorphin rush that I got from watching the color version of Galaxy 4 was amazing. Very exciting.
Yeah, I'm like you. I'll always choose a black and white one. I know that, well, obviously they've got to be in color because commercially, I think as well, it makes it's nice for people to have the option, but also I think commercially a color release in is probably more viable. I personally like a black and white animation. To be honest, my favorite way of watching these is a good telesnap reconstruction with any surviving bits put in there. That's how, I know some people are just like, absolutely cannot watch telesnaps or stuff. I love a good telesnap reconstruction, so I'm also looking forward to that.
Yeah, the loose cannon reconstructions, which are kind of the gold standard, are mostly available on Daily Motion. And there have been other versions floating around the internet and YouTube over the years, and I have copies of some of those, but loose cannon goes out of their way to animate whenever they can, such as flickering torches or CGI Yeti or CGI Daleks, or for Evil of the Daleks, they have people walking through a house to augment the photographs. So these were low-res recons done 20 years ago before advances in high-def picture. But what they do on top of the photographs is really wonderful.
Yeah, it's great stuff. I'm very excited to be talking about this on Trap One in a couple of weeks. So listen out for that.
Yes.
I'm doing a save it for the podcast moment.
I do not want to steal the thunder of that episode for sure. So thank you for the sneak preview. And of course, I encourage everybody to listen to Trap One and hear that episode when it comes out. So in terms of your Doctor Who watching, where have you been at lately? I mean, all of us are building up to... There is theoretically the centenary episode coming up next month, although nobody knows when or what time. But what are you doing in preparation for that moment?
Not much, really. I think the recent I watched all of the season 22 box set. I sort of got through that, which I thoroughly enjoyed. When I knew I was doing The Time Warrior, I had absolutely no hesitation in digging out the DVD and rewatching it, because any excuse to rewatch The Time Warrior is good for me. In terms of preparing, even mentally or in any other way, about the centenary special, I'm not. I think it'll land when it lands. And, you know, Chris Chibnall has brought a lot of really interesting, really cool stuff. His choices of publicity, I think, are really puzzling. I think it's wonderful to keep one thing he's really been able to do is achieve the impossible and keep secrets. You know, so we've had lots of reveals that we had no idea were coming, which in this day and age is nigh on impossible. And I have to applaud him for the secrets and surprises he's continued springing. I think on the flip side of that, it's unfortunate that the fact that Doctor Who is on television is also a secret. I think that's unfortunate. So, you know, swings and roundabouts. So we'll get what we'll get. I think I'll just take it on face value and enjoy it. How about you? What have you been watching lately?
I'll just say about Chibnall's publicity blackout that it's always 50-50 for me whether or not I'm going to be spoiled during a particular season finale. Like, I did not know about the big cliffhanger leading into Doomsday. I didn't know it was going to be Cybermen versus Daleks. Mm-hmm. That was an amazing reveal. Fell off the couch. The next year, I had already been spoiled about who John Sim was playing. The year after that, a random YouTube pop-up spoiled to me that Davros was coming back. So up until Chibnall came along, I was never sure if I knew the big secret before it dropped or not. It was about half and half. With Chibnall, I've always been caught off guard. I had no idea that the Fugitive Doctor was coming. I had no idea about the Timeless Child. Some of the bigger revelations in the Flux, again, no idea they were coming. And the stuff that the BBC announced, like they announced that Captain Jack is coming back, and that was a great decoy because it disguises the real spoil to that episode. So they've told us, obviously, that Tegan and Ace are coming back for the centenary, and that, of course, has got to be a smokescreen. I'm sure other stuff is coming back.
Yeah, I'm excited about that. That would be nice to see some old faces there.
Yeah, and there are rumors that, you know, we're going to have a Zoom-style reunion of all the surviving companions across all eras. I don't know if that's true or not, but I'm looking for a more creative spoiler than that, and I'm sure Chibnall will deliver.
Yeah, that's true. He has been the master of surprises so far, so I'm sure he's got more in store for us.
And speaking of Chibnall, in terms of my ongoing pilgrimage, which you can follow along at the hashtag DrWhoPilgrimage on Twitter, I just finished the Peter Capaldi era last night.
I saw your tweet. Overall, how's that been for you?
When I was tweeting my way through the classic series, it was the best 45 minutes of the day. Even for a bad episode, there were always things about it that I would enjoy. I would say that any given episode was my favorite, even if only for a few seconds. And there were very few dull patches all the way through. The only times during the entire classic series pilgrimage that I got antsy was during the doldrums of the very end of the Troughton era. There's an unfortunate run of stories between Wheel in Space and Space Pirates where paying attention is a bit of a struggle. There are some great episodes in that mix, but the overall stretch is I can't wait for the Pertwee era to arrive. And then it's unadulterated greatness between season 7 and the beginning of season 15. And then it doesn't really get unfortunate for me again until parts of the Colin Baker / early Sylvester McCoy era. But by and large, just watching the classic series straight through was an exercise in joy. What surprised me the most is I have not had the same vibe out of the new series. Rose and End of the World are an incredible 1-2 punch to start off that version of the pilgrimage. But there's a lot of stuff that has aged very, very poorly about the new series, which surprises me, because obviously you watch Twice Upon a Time, as I did last night, and it paints the first Doctor in a very, very bad light, at least for the first half hour. And I was disappointed in that because I am a big Hartnell fan, and that era is much better than a lot of people give it credit for. So you have the first Doctor being painted as an unreconstructed sexist for about 30 to 40 minutes in Twice Upon a Time. But at the same time, the first Doctor era is the era produced and co-created by Verity Lambert. It's the era that gives us Barbara Wright, whereas the Moffat era, it seems that there's a fat joke at the expense of a female companion almost every week. So really, who's making fun of whom here?
Yeah, no, that's a good point. I don't know if it's my age or whatever, but I was saying to a friend the other day, if I'm going to just sort of pull out a Doctor Who to watch for fun, it's 10 times out of 10 a classic era. But it's just that's because I think that's just more my thing. There is obviously fantastic stuff in the new series which I love, but yeah, I'm finding myself, you know, for the comforts, I definitely always go for the classic.
If I were to do a top 20 of the top 20 Doctor Who stories that I could watch over and over again without ever getting tired or bored, I would say probably at least 13 or 14 of the 20 would be classic series. I've never actually tried such a list, but looking at it informally, I could watch Aztecs over and over again, never get bored.
Oh my goodness.
I could watch War Games or Invasion over and over again, never get bored. City of Death, I have watched over and over again, I've never gotten bored. Caves of Androzani, over and over again, never gets dull, never gets weak. Same with almost any story from season 18. Full Circle on Legopolis, I have worn clean on VHS, and I always find. I always love those stories as much on the 21st and 34th viewings as I did on the first and second. So those are my all-time titans from the classic. From the new series, there are probably at least 5 episodes in the new series that I would put on the same level. God Complex, I think, is phenomenal, tremendous. Rose, again, the direction for Rose has not been the best direction that you get in the new series, but I have watched Rose multiple times, and I will never lose that joy that I got when I saw it for the very first time in 2005. And then there are a couple of – like watching the Monks trilogy, I was impressed with how excellent each one of those 3 episodes were. I remember the Monk trilogy being a disappointment, but each episode had individual terrific moments, and that was a wonderfully pleasant surprise.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah, I think for me, the first one that pops into my head when I think of a new series, if I had to, like, one that I absolutely love, I mean, it's Midnight. I absolutely adore Midnight. And there's all kinds of stuff in there. It's interesting that differentiate old and new as classic and new. But I've always been interested in I live in Oxford and often end up knocking around lots of very professorial types, and I had a very good sort of definition of a work of classic literature is one that you come back to, a story that you can come back to, and you find it reveals more and more each time you come back to it. And I think with that definition, there are lots of classics in inverted commas in the new series. I think there are plenty of stories in the new series that fall under that category that are very rich and very deep. I think it's just that I'm old, so I like comforting things increasingly.
Oh, absolutely. And again, I am a Doctor Who fan. I always watch every new episode the day that it drops to the extent that I can here in the States. And I'm never going to reject the classic. I'm never going to reject the new series, I should say. But I am surprised at how much more I've enjoyed the original 1963 to 1989 run compared to the 2005 to 2022 run. So I'm taking a 5-day break because season 5 of Cobra Kai drops on Netflix today. So I'm going to watch that 2 episodes a night between now and Tuesday. And I will give a shout out to Cobra Kai, which season 2, episode 9, did a long breakdown of the Stephen Moffat era in universe, in show.
Wow.
And two friends who had become enemies bond over Jodie Whittaker being cast as the Doctor. So somebody in the Cobra Kai writers' room is probably having the same conversation about classic versus new series right now.
It's catharsis for them. It's catharsis for them, I think.
So once that is over, once I finish season 5, I will restart the Jodie Whittaker era, starting with Women Who Fell to Earth. And there's only what? There's only 30 episodes of the Jodie Whittaker era total. I should be able to watch all 30 of those in 30 days. And if the centenary drops in mid-October, I should be able to watch the centenary as the final episode of my 30-day Jodie Whittaker pilgrimage.
Wow. Okay, that's exciting. That's exciting. That's a good way of doing it.
And now that I'm commuting back to the office for work a few days a month, I don't always have 45 minutes in the day. Or the way that I watch, also doing my tweets, takes a little more than an hour. I don't always have the time. I want to make every effort to finish the Jodie pilgrimage to coincide with the airing of her final episode. And I'm curious, because I have not had a positive impression of the Chibnall era, even though I love the work that Jodie Whittaker is doing. I love the work that Mandip Gill is doing. So I'm setting a challenge for myself when I start the Jodie era in a few days. I am curious to see what agency the character is given and how much the Doctor herself is involved in winning the day and solving the plots, as opposed to standing around in front of a green screen while somebody barks exposition out of her for 20 minutes. My working theory going in is that, and again, you don't blame the actor for this because the actor does not write and produce the show. They're only showing up and reading their pages, their sides. You don't blame Jodie Whittaker if the era is not good because that's somebody else's fault. She does amazing work. My working theory is that she is tremendously underserved by the material and is rarely given a chance to be heroic. Maybe that is a false impression because of Timeless Child, where she stands there for 20 minutes while somebody yells at her. I'm very curious to go episode by episode and see if she has the kind of agency that Peter Capaldi's Doctor was given. And we'll see how that works out.
Yeah, it's always good to go back and review things, and it changes over time. I just mentioned I watched season 22, and I found that Revelation of the Daleks, for instance, which I've seen a million times, I enjoyed it this time more than I ever have before. It almost transformed in front of my eyes. You know, these things do. And I sometimes think it's good to go back and challenge yourself to watch those things that you're less keen on. I did like, for me, my we've all got our era that's speaks to us less than others, and for me it was the 12th Doctor era. I didn't connect with any of it at any point at all, pretty much, and so I went back and I did a just conscious rewatch where I just watched 12th Doctors for a while, and I sort of tweet about it every day, and you know, some stuff changed, some stuff didn't, but it'll change again in time. So I think it's a good thing to go back and, you know, as this mad show just like expands and expands, you know, over time things will keep changing, so it's always good to revisit it.
And of course, context is king. If you watch Revelation of the Daleks at random after 3 weeks of not having watched Doctor Who at all, it might not land. But if you're watching it immediately after Time Lash in sequence, it is like the oasis in the desert.
Yeah, exactly. Watching them as part of seasons definitely helps. Well, here we are worrying about time, and really we should be getting onto the time warrior. That is the thanks for that pity laugh. That's the lamest segue I could come up with.
So you watched Time Warrior in preparation for this show.
And read it too, yeah.
So how long had it been you watched Time Warrior last?
Probably only about 4 or 5 years. It's a story that talk about comfort and classic stuff. Time Warrior, if you put that on, that's always going to be a good time. And as I said earlier, that sort of definition of a classic, each time you see it, you get more from it. And it just makes me, it's such a funny story. It's so joyful and so funny and really clever. Like every single character, even obviously there are scenes here that have been cut, but every single character, basically, when you make the characters so good, any character can interact with anyone else and it always works. So you can do anything. Once you've got characters that good and a basic premise this strong, you can do anything with it. I've so enjoyed rewatching it and rereading it. How about you?
When I watched it as part of my pilgrimage, coming immediately after the Green Death, it was the first time that I'd ever less than fully loved the story, because right after Green Death, the Doctor's lack of chemistry with Sarah Jane in part 1 is pretty stunning after 3 years of incredible chemistry between the Third Doctor and Joe Grant. So for that first night when I watched parts one and part two, I'm like, oh no, my favorite story is no longer my favorite. But then you come to part three, where the Doctor and Sarah finally get together. She kidnaps him. She realizes he's not a bad guy. And how amazing that she launches an army and kidnaps him in her very first story. That
is incredible. Yeah.
As I'll point out later, each John Pertwee companion was introduced in a story written by Robert Holmes. And Sarah probably gets the best introduction out of those three.
Definitely. Yeah, it's an incredibly strong. Even, you know, you see the character. You can see the sort of the seeds of it, and you can see some stuff that gets slightly dropped and some stuff that will get developed later. But it's a really strong introduction for a character. Loads to do. And obviously, you know, Liz Sladen completely smashed it and is in her element. So that sells it hugely. I'm just like, she's my favorite companion. So it's just so sweet just to see her and see her first story. I will always love it. It's probably one of the reasons I go back and watch it fairly frequently.
And Kevin Lindsay's performance as Linx. It took a long time for another Sontaran story to be as good as this one, because he sets the bar so high. The Sontarans are clone warriors. He has such a distinct and vivid and entertaining personality that no Sontaran was ever able to measure up after that for the longest, longest time. So if Time Warrior, if we accept this is the best Sontaran story ever, what is the second best?
Well, I was thinking that, and it was, for a while I just thought, oh, the Sontarans in their appearances, not the story, but the actual quality of the characterization in each story, it was complete diminishing returns for me in each story. It has to be said, which was like Chris Chibnall, another strength of his is bringing back classic monsters, and War of the Sontarans is... I mean, not in terms of the story, but just purely in terms of characterization of the Sontarans, could arguably be vying for a second place. I love the two Doctors, but I don't think the Sontarans are at their peak. Invasion of Time just doesn't do it for me at all. So my joint second is Sontaran Experiment with War of the Sontarans, if I'm allowed. How about you?
Sontaran Experiment... When I submitted my review of that to the ratings guide after the DVD came out in 2007, I titled my review "The Year's Least Essential DVD Release." I don't think Sontaran Experiment on TV is a great story. However, that said, the novelization is coming up, and the novelization is a whole different ballgame, but that is owing entirely to Ian Martyr.
Ian Martyr, yeah.
But Kevin Lindsay was ill. That limited what they could do with the character. He passed away shortly thereafter. So if the story doesn't work, it is not Kevin Lindsay's fault. I love Invasion of Time, but not because of the Sontarans. That story, I think, is one on the strength of Tom Baker and the first four episodes, more so than the Sontarans chasing their way through the TARDIS. Two Doctors, again, has a lot to recommend about it, but the Sontarans, again, are not the strong point in the story. You have the two-parter from the David Tennant era. Christopher Ryan is mesmerizing. And apart from that, the script, I think, lets him down. Because the human turncoat villain is a major weak link in the story. And then you have the unit troops running around, and they're not as well done as they had been during the Pertwee era. So the Sontaran stratagem / poison sky is never going to be comfort viewing for me, even as much as I love Christopher Ryan's performance. And then, of course, he comes back to play the Sontaran later on. Dan Starkey is great. Strax is great, but he's there as comic relief. He's a one-joke character, and the joke is never not funny. But he's not really a Sontaran, and since we never see him at war until War of the Sontarans, when he comes back as an antagonist. So this is a long way around of saying that I think War of the Sontarans is the second best Sontaran story.
Right. Okay. Yeah. All right. That's interesting. Very interesting.
Because the Sontarans are funny and they're witty, but they're also a threat and they've conquered the Earth and they're dangerous. And they're allowed to have a Linx-like personality, a Sontaran who invades the planet Earth because he wants to ride a horse.
That's great. That's, yeah. That's inspired.
Yeah, it's. I can hear like Robert Holmes writing that kind of stuff. I love. I mean, the Sontarans are one of my. I'm in Doctor Who for the monsters. I love the monsters. I think the Sontarans are fantastic. And I think I was trying to sort of work out where all this came from. And Robert Holmes, apparently at the end of World War II, was the youngest serving officer in the British Army. So he's obviously got some. He's got that in his blood, his DNA. Like he understands and has got an interest in that. And I think what's absolutely fantastic is knowing what the budget of Doctor Who is like. He thought, you know, he wanted the, you know, the idea was a militaristic race who could clone, so there are just waves and waves of them, which is a great idea. But understanding Doctor Who's budget, illustrating an entire species with just one is a brilliant idea, and it works incredibly well. You don't need, as marvelous as the CGI armies in the War of Sontarans and the Crimean War looked. It's absolute genius to have one of them, and it's always fascinating. It looks so, one thing that you know, you can't talk about Linx without talking about that bloody costume and mask. Has never been bettered, ever. You know that I'm holding up the front, that beautiful front cover now. That is incredible. It's almost unclockable, and you have to fight. Yes. If you watch it. When you watch it, you have to fight your imagination to say, there's a man in there, there's a man in there, he's got an ordinary shaped head. It just, your imagination will snap back to that Sontaran head and that Sontaran voice. He's so believable. It's a beautiful costume, a beautiful performance. He's one of the greatest monsters in Doctor Who. I mean, fight me. and this cover as well, it has to be, yeah.
This is a cover by Roy Knipe. It is his first illustration, and that is a photograph like illustration that is so high quality. It's hard to believe it's a guy with a paintbrush.
It really, really is. It's absolutely fantastic. I had a look because the last time I was on here, I did Planet of the, we did talked about Planet of the Daleks, and Roy Knipe had done an alternative unused cover, slightly similar to his Death to the Daleks cover with these gorgeous Daleks, which I raved about. So this is one of Roy Knipe's first of six used illustrations that he did, and I think you're probably entering the Roy Knipe segment of Doctor Who releases now, I believe. So you've got some of his classics coming up. Well, I mean, you're holding
I'm
up
holding
Death
up
to the Daleks.
You.
Death to the Daleks. I'm going to leave. I was going to say I'm going to leave that because that cover has to be dealt with next week by whoever your lucky guest is for that one. But yeah, you've got some great covers of his coming up: Android Invasion, Sontaran Experiment, another Sontaran one, Hand of Fear, Invisible Enemy. But this cover for Time Warrior, who could ask for anything more? And it's interesting. I've got the DVD here, and Clayton Hickman has clearly not strayed too far from that with a very similar photograph with the giant golf ball spaceship in the background.
Almost
love links.
Wow.
Yeah. And we've got to get into this prologue. Sorry. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we'll get to it. But in terms of the story itself, I'm still cavilling over the story. We have to talk about David Dacre as Captain Irongron.
Absolutely.
Is he the best human villain of the Pertwee era?
I mean, let's have a think about the air, because of course Delgado isn't human. So yeah, he is. He absolutely is. It's a wonderful performance. It's every bit as well matched for Linx. The character, it's so funny. He's a hilarious character with Blood Axe. He's fantastic against Linx. I could watch that forever. Like Doctor Who could be a program about that. You know, every week they should be in every story. It's the strength of characterization and to funnel your themes of past and present, time travel, everything Doctor Who's about, and to characterize it and pit them against each other for the whole story. And you feel the sort of journey of their relationship when they completely don't understand each other, when they're in, you know, they're in awe of each other, as the tensions start to grow, there's a bit of a bromance in the middle. It's all there, and it is a thing of absolute beauty. It's a thing of beauty.
What impresses me the most is that in most alien invasion stories, the alien is evil, and there is some human dupe who is along for the ride, believing they're going to get all their rewards, but they are meant to be sacrificed as soon as their utility is over. And the whiny American teenage genius in Sontaran Stratagem / Poison Sky falls right into that category. What's special about Time Warrior is that Linx
really does treat Irongron as an equal. Up until part four, he is working, making guns and an alien robot android for this guy. He even warns him that your castle is going to be destroyed when I take off. Go find another one with the weapons that I gave you. They are an equal partnership as much as you can be between a futuristic alien general and a medieval warlord. So yes, they're funny and they fight and they argue, but it's genuinely funny when they do, and they are equal partners. And yes, one kills the other at the end, but it's earned by the script, and there's never a sense that Irongron is a dupe who is just being taken for a ride, which happens in so many other... Like, he is not Lee Sen Chang, who is ill-used and cast aside by Magnus Greel as soon as his plot utility ends in Part 3. Irongron and Linx are equal partners until the end, and that makes for great drama in every scene they're in. And I'll play an audio clip from the end of Part 4 a little bit later on during this program, but they're just as good in Part 1 as they are in Part 4, which is rare.
Yeah, absolutely. And you can feel that, you know, they're, like you said, they're incredibly well matched, but you know there's, you know, that it's a sort of grudging alliance, but there is respect there, mutual respect, and you know it's going to have to end sort of badly. But the fun is watching that build up and build up. It's incredibly powerful stuff. It's some of the best characterization you'll see in Doctor Who, and Robert Holmes is a genius at that.
So we've been talking for more than half an hour, and I'm torturing you by delaying the moment when we talk about the book. So let's finally get to it. And a little bit later on, I will play your excerpt. But let's talk about this prologue. What can you tell me, Conrad, about this prologue?
Yeah, I mean, I remember this from being, I think, obviously I would have got this book when I was, I don't know how old I'd have been, but you know, in single digits, but I think I really got into it. And I think it really appealed to me as a teenager. I mean, my friend at school we loved the Sontarans. Like, we were really obsessed with the Sontarans. And again, it was this question of, you know, you didn't have the stuff on video, so you had to kind of find it wherever you could. And I remember poring over that prologue, and it's very straight sci-fi. It's all about military maneuvers. You know, this lone reconnaissance ship, being pursued by nine Rutan fighters. And it's sort of a bit unusual for a Doctor Who book. It's quite long. It's not just like a little prologue. It's it was originally a chapter. So it's quite a hefty thing. And I think appealed to me as a teenager was just the sort of serious sci-fi space battle, you know, and I always loved seeing inside the monsters' minds. Like, I know in Doctor Who Weekly in the comic strips, they used to have a comic strip at the back dedicated to the monsters, and I always loved that. The early TV comic Dalek strips, I was fascinated by their culture and everything, and you learn a lot about Sontarans in this. I love it dearly. I was also amused to find out how it came about that. So Robert Holmes, Terrance Dicks, and Barry Letts, when they were thinking up stories for this season, they thought they hadn't done a historical for a while. Holmes wasn't massively keen on doing historicals. He didn't like famous people, or as we call them, celebrity historicals. So he wanted to have that mixture. So he came up with a script, The Time Fugitive, got later known as The Time Survivor. And Holmes started it by writing extracts from a military journal by the Sontaran officer commando Linx, Jingo Linx, and he sent it to Terrance Dicks in the form of a memo addressed to Terran Sedix from Field Marshal Hol Mess. And it's like, he really loved that. You know, he was clearly really entrenched in that whole thing. I think that's very beautiful. That memo eventually turned into the first chapter for the novelization, which he then realized he wasn't really his bag, handed it over to Terrance, who morphed it into this prologue. So it's just, I just love that line of how this thing ended up as this prologue in this book. But yes, I love it because it's unusual. I love it because my teen self just loves this sort of straight military sci-fi stuff of it, which is not really usually my bag. I much more prefer big fantasy camp, colourful stuff. But actually, I really enjoy this prologue. It's a wonderful insight into the Sontarans. And also, it's really nice that it's almost condensed into the story in one line of dialogue in which Linx just says, I was on a reconnaissance mission when attacked by a squadron of Rutan fighters. And that's in the story, it's in the book. And it's lovely to have this prologue to sort of, you know, you, with Doctor Who, often you get a little suggestive idea and you'd love to know what about that world, about that culture. And here you actually get it in a good meaty section of interesting sort of space opera. It's fabulous.
And as we mentioned earlier, we feel Terrance Dicks upping his game over the rest of the book. If the book is 138 pages long, Robert Holmes writes the first 10, Terrance writes the other 138. He is matching Robert Holmes' prose style for the other 138 pages, and considering he has a book coming out a month after this one, he doesn't necessarily have the time to write a full-on epic, and yet he manages to do it anyway. He manages to channel Robert Holmes for the entire story.
What are the... I'm curious, you said this. What are the... Because I think you read more of these than I do, and you've certainly read more recently than I have. So what are you noticing about Dix's writing that's changing here or being influenced here, or that he's deliberately matching tonally?
So if you're listening to this podcast on the day that it's released, I will have already read out an excerpt from David J. Howe's The Target Book. I found a one-paragraph excerpt in there of Terrance Dix talking about his original style writing the novelizations versus how he had to change and adapt once he was writing a book a month. So when I went into this project, I was working under the theory that his first five or six books were great, and then after that he immediately sacrificed quality in terms of quantity and started churning out simple 100-page script-to-book transcripts without much meat. That was my working impression going in, because that's generally the received wisdom. What's amazing is that the received wisdom is wrong. So let's go down the calendar. January 77, Carnival of Monsters, based on a Robert Holmes script, very entertaining. March 77, Dalek Invasion of Earth, 140 pages. April 77, Claws of Access, 140 pages. May 77, Brain of Morbius, 140 pages. All these books are really, you know, tightly written, small print. He preserves a lot of the script and adds a lot of flavor. Then he does Planet of Evil in July, Mutants in September, Deadly Assassin in October. These are shorter books, and some of them are better than others. But then in November 77, he does another 140 page, Talons of Wang Chiang, again Robert Holmes. It is, in fact, his second straight Robert Holmes book in a row after Deadly Assassin. And the detail that he puts in Talons of Wang Chiang is remarkable. Plus, he manages to fix or blunt some of the more unfortunate cultural aspects of that script. Then he has a month off. He does Face of Evil. He does Horror of Fang Rock. And then he does Time Warrior. So he is writing at a breakneck pace, and he is still managing to do 140-page book after 140-page book. I have yet to reach the era where he's doing these short, simple 100 pages. It just hasn't happened yet. So he's keeping up his intensity for much longer than I ever thought he would. And I don't want to give away the game when I'm doing my breakdown of the book, but I'm going to be breaking down the book chapter by chapter, 17 chapters, and there is something amazing that's worth a mini essay in every one of those 17 chapters. He changes the fate of one character to give one character a happy ending, which doesn't happen on television. He adds a fascinatingly dark wrinkle to the Irongron Linx relationship. I won't say where in the book it is, but I'll tell you now, just between you and me, there is a moment in the book that is not hinted at and is not visible on TV. This is Terrance coming up with that out of whole cloth. There is a moment where Irongron realizes that he can kill Linx right now and almost does it. And that's, I'll go into more detail later. It's amazing that Terrance gives Irongron this moment, because Linx is going to kill him at the very end of the story. He gives Irongron the realization, wait a minute, maybe this is not a partnership of full equals. Maybe I need to do this now to save myself. I already have the weapons. Maybe this is a good time. And he doesn't, because obviously the story can't end that way. But for Terrance, in the middle of writing a stretch of long books, month after month after month, to come up with that insight when he has another book due out a month after this and the deadline is mounting, wow. I don't have that level of imagination.
Yeah, it's amazing the job he's done on this. Crucially, there's a couple of things I noticed were so he's reinstated two scenes that were in the script and cut. The scene where the Squire Eric gets captured, the rabbit as Irongron describes him.
Yes.
And I think you picked this one up. A scene between Hal the Archer and Mary, the prettiest serving wench in the whole castle.
I will be doing a slight dramatic reenactment of that. It's in my script that I haven't recorded yet, but I will say that when I was messaging you to schedule this recording, and I was in the middle of reading the book when you messaged me, I get to that page, immediately put the book down, start messaging you, OMG, I've just discovered a sex scene in a Target novelization.
Unbelievable. I found myself and then prepared and got the smelling salts ready and then read said lusty passage, and my goodness me, it's a medieval bodice ripper and no mistake.
I actually use that exact line in my script. So
I mean,
when you hear me use the exact words in about 20 minutes time.
Okay, I will not take credit for that, yeah.
Independent of one another, we came up with it. But yeah, Terrance must have really been enjoying himself in his... We've now all seen the room where he wrote these books on his typewriter, thanks to Frank Skinner and the Blu-ray special feature. So yes. We can now picture Terrance sitting at his desk, satisfying himself, writing that passage.
Absolutely superb stuff. And that scene is cut, is cooled. It's a bucket of water is thrown on their ardour by Lady Eleanor, who with an you may be covering this later, but I had to mention these little tweaks and little tonal things that the detail and colour that Terrance adds to this is Lady Eleanor suggests that Hal shoots Irongron. She's the one that suggests it. And I do love that detail, which I'm sure you picked up on, is of Hal shooting him from a grassy knoll. I quite enjoyed that.
That I'd missed.
Which I thought that was quite, that made me chuckle. But also, so Lady Eleanor suggests that he does that. And then I think she, later on in the plotting scene, is very keen to she's the one that suggests, I think, to Sir Edward to go, I know, we're going to send Hal to go and do this. So it seems very much coming from her. And then later on in the book, when the Doctor is making his noxious potion to, throw these homemade explosives, Terrance says that Lady Eleanor has a gleam in her eye, saying, "Ah, is it a poison? Is it a potion to poison the dog?" With a glint in her eye, so he's given her this Lady Macbeth sort of vibe that she's the power behind the sort of. death crazed assassin, which I love. I love those details.
This was famously the story that was meant to introduce women's lib to the Doctor Who universe in the character of Sarah Jane. Terrance, in a couple of moments in the novelization, gives more agency to Sarah Jane and more agency to Lady Eleanor than they get on television. So as much as Terrance plays the Tory on the DVD audio commentaries, and as much as he laughs off the idea of we don't know what feminism is, he's giving it more than lip service. He is actually writing, in many ways, a feminist novelization, giving the women more to do than they got on television. And the way that he talks on the DVDs, you wouldn't figure him to be that kind of writer, but it turns out he is.
Yeah, and I noticed he made a trim. One of the trims he made was to, I think, when Sarah realizes that the Doctor isn't responsible for the kidnapping and sort of admits she's wrong, the Doctor in the TV show, in the original script, sort of says, oh, what a generous admission, from one of the fairer sex. And Terrance trims that out. So he's got, that sort of slightly cheeky bluster he has about not standing for any of that stuff. He's, he's got his eye on the ball and he knows what's right for the book. And he just with great taste and almost duty of care for these books and the readership, it's,
to quote and characters. The favorite era of the show, Peter Capaldi. Yes. He has a duty of care towards his companions.
Yeah. I think that's, I love that. I also enjoyed a scene in which we see Sarah as a big fan of Sarah Jane. She was my companion. I love that the scene, any scene where you got to see inside the TARDIS or any other room in the TARDIS was always incredibly exciting. So the fact he adds the Sarah hiding in a wardrobe off the console room, I love that. And thinking to herself that as soon as she get the first opportunity, she's going to go straight to the highest authority in the government and report him. You know, like, again, that's very, you see that journalist instinct, you see that, again, just adding great character to her, even though she gets it wrong. Brilliant. Lovely, lovely addition.
I will be talking a little bit later in the program about the wardrobe and a couple of other Chronicles of Narnia reference that Terrance had worked into the two books before he wrote this one. I'm curious if he was intentionally putting some C.S. Lewis in the novelizations or if that was just cultural osmosis and it just happened unconsciously. But between two chapters in two previous books being called The Last Battle and Sarah hiding in the wardrobe before stepping out into another universe, it can't be a coincidence, can it?
I've never sort of come across that before. I didn't know about it, but now you say it, that does make sense, that whole wardrobe thing. And there's a moment where she steps out into this new land, and he adds a lovely bit of just character detail to her. Similarly to when Rose, in The Unquiet Dead, Russell T. Davis gives her that moment where she steps out onto the snow and just very deliberately thinks, oh, I'm stepping on snow that's in the past. Terrance gives Sarah this moment of when she lands, she notices how clean the air is with no pollution and everything. What a lovely detail. It only takes a sentence, but it transports us there, it transports her there. Lovely, lovely, lovely stuff.
So in this book, you have Sarah debuting, you have one of the great aliens in Linx, you have one of the great human villains in Irongron, you have John Pertwee at his peak. This is the story with a line. A straight line may be the shortest distance between two points, but it is by no means the most interesting. This is the peak of the Pertwee era in many ways, because it just goes from strength to strength to strength. And I think we both agree this is a book that matches the strengths of the TV production.
Yeah, it's written on very, very solid foundations. And yeah, Terrance does Robert Holmes' script incredible justice, adds to it beautifully, makes lovely little tweaks. And he does it sort of very unintrusively. It doesn't interrupt in the word count, but he'll just say things like in the battle scene, he'll explain about why the explosives were so shocking to the locals. You know, he explains that, oh, this was an age which explosions were unknown. So bangs and flashes, da da da. And it leads very nicely into the dialogue. He says things like the panic spread like a plague. I'm just like, those lovely, just lovely descriptions to put us there is great stuff. And also, every day's a learning day with Terrance. So I learnt the words embrasure. I didn't know what an embrasure was. Embrasure. I mean, you get from the context, it's something to do with the turrets, but it's specifically the angled turrets. The turrets that kind of are narrow at the front, and as you're behind them, they're widened out there. I didn't know that word. I also didn't know the word for lorgnette. Lorgnette. Who knew? Which is basically opera glasses. I'm not a classy person. I didn't know that. But regardless, those are great words to put, you know, so he's just two of them, but like, fantastic. It had me rushing for my dictionary, age 50-something, so that's wonderful as well. I mean, you know, this is a gift. This is really, really strong stuff.
I've said this before, but here in the States, for the young reader today of the year 2022, reading right now is heavily regimented. Books are categorized by reading level and by grade level, and when you get to school, you're given a reading grade, and you stay in that level, and you only read books out of that bucket until you graduate to the next level. So those books are very carefully, carefully structured so that you're getting the vocabulary only fitting that level and a complexity of writing only fitting that level. Terrance Dicks is not doing any of that. He is putting complicated vocabulary words and concepts and some pretty stunningly dark moments into books that are being read by 8- and 9-year-old kids. I think he does so much to foster a love of reading by writing for adults in kids' books, which could not happen in young adult fiction today.
Nothing to add. I mean, absolutely. It's great. There's plenty in there for the adults. Like I said, the grassy knoll reference I enjoyed, and I enjoyed learning these words. And he peppers it with little historical things as well that are not mentioned. When the doctor goes to shoot the robot control box, with a bow and arrow, you know, that he just gets in that quick line. The Doctor had had lessons from William Tell once, you know, just not going to disturb the word count, but going to give you a little bit of historical, you know, educational value, which Doctor Who's good for. I also enjoyed the, I think there's the slightly fixing things that got slightly lost in the TV show, so the or improving things on them. I think he gave the robot knight a bit of polish in this story. I like the fact that he refers to it as the Black Knight, because that's one bit that doesn't, is one costume that doesn't, that robot doesn't come up as nicely as it could do, because they've built it so it can have its head knocked off, so it looks a bit ridiculous. And the idea of a, it was originally the Black Knight, and the Black Knight was, I looked up, was a 19, because I thought, where's that coming from? And there was a, it was made famous in a 1954 Technicolor British-American adventure, you know, swashbuckling medieval adventure film, which also starred, had Alan Ladd, also starred Peter Cushing and one Patrick Troughton. But that Black Knight thing, it just adds that romance to the story. And I think, and Terrence even adds a little bit of wit to it by, obviously we can, you know, you can see when the Doctor pretty much looks at the robot knight and strokes his chin and goes, I've got an idea. You probably can guess how it's going. But in this, Terrence just describes the scene of Irongron and the robot knight coming in. And it's not until a little while in, like when Irongron says, I know, let's stick some crossbows through it or something. And then Terrence reveals that the Doctor's inside him, saying, oh, the Doctor sighed or something. It's a nice comic effect. So he just sort of seeds a bit of that comedy back into that scene again. Just bit of polish on that robot. Lovely.
And he also adds in a couple of brief Robin Hood references because it's era appropriate. And he changes on page 98, where the Doctor on TV desires to take lessons from Rembrandt. He actually has the Doctor having already studied under Rembrandt.
It's very funny. It's terribly funny stuff.
A nifty little change. So, and, having talked about the book and the episode and our various pilgrimages, what I want to do now is put you to the test by playing a game.
Okay.
That I am going to throw down the gauntlet, medieval style, and I'm going to challenge you to a game of 20 questions.
Okay, let's do this. I'm ready. I don't know if we really needed to be in the dungeon for this, and I'm manacled here, so I can't escape, but I will accept my fate. Let's give it a go.
Nobody,
20 questions.
Nobody has failed yet, so we'll see if you are the first person who fails to escape the dungeon.
There's a first time for everything. I accept my fate with honor.
I have selected one random Doctor Who story between 1963 and the present, 2022. Could be any story from any one of those years. You have 20 yes or no questions to guess what it is. Question number one.
Well, question number one, is it a classic era story?
Yes, it is. And talking about classic as in the 1963 to 1989 series, not classic as in a story that bears repeating over and over again.
Thank you very much for that. That's a definition there. So is it a color story?
It is not a color story.
Okay. Is it a Patrick Troughton story?
It is a Patrick Troughton story. Now, I'll point out to you that you're on question four.
Oh, yes.
The all-time record is the Cy Hart record, 7 questions. You have a 3 in, I guess, 20 chance of breaking Simon Hart's record. Because you have the Doctor right, only about 20 Troughton stories. If you get it in 3 or 4, you could become a record holder.
Wow. Okay. Well, I'm not going to put that pressure on myself. So I'm going to, I think I'm going to go for, would be a good, let's just try and go for a companion question. I'm not going to say Jamie because he's in most of them. So I'm going to ask if, is Victoria in this story?
Yes, Victoria is in this story. Question 5. You have a chance of shattering records here if you play your cards right.
I'm going to keep going for narrowing down questions. I'm not going to... let's have a think. Does this story... does this story have a returning enemy in it?
Yes, it does have a returning enemy. That leads us to question 6.
Okay. I think now I'm just going to blindly start shouting stories and see what happens. Okay, so it's a Victoria story with a returning enemy in it. Okay, is it... Hang on. Let me think. Is there another way I can break this down? No, I'm going to go for it. Is it Evil of the Daleks?
That's your question. Is it Evil of the Daleks? You're just going straight chronological order.
Is the story Evil of the Daleks, yes or no?
Well, the answer to that question is you are now the all-time record holder. You got it in six. Yes, it is Evil of the Daleks. You have dethroned Simon Hart, and I don't know if anybody is ever going to break the new Conrad record of guessing the story in six questions. Congratulations.
Shut the front door. What?
You got it. It was
Evil of the Daleks. I'm going to need a moment here. I don't know if you've heard my Planet of the Daleks thing, where I went on record as saying I absolutely loathe quizzes and games. I never play them. The only time I ever play them is with you because I like you. I am absolutely gobsmacked. Do I get anything?
I am tempted now to just play the game again and have you play twice in the same broadcast to see if you can do just as well the second time around.
I'm a bit shaken. I kind of can't believe that. I'm notoriously bad at quizzes, but I don't know what to say. I'm completely speechless. Wow, and that means you're going to have to tell everyone in each story now. Like, the record to beat is me. Someone's going to beat it, though. And I bet you it's Mark McManus, because he's a cheeky one. And I notice he likes to come on and throw in for his... Because he's very brave. He likes to throw in for his first guess. He will just try and guess the story. One day, that scoundrel, that knave, is going to... If anyone's going to do... It's going to be him. But anyway, right now, that's incredible. I'm gobsmacked.
Having met Mark... And there's a photo of him and me in Times Square together. It looks as if I'm standing in a ditch. He is truly a long-shanked rascal.
He certainly is. He's offensively tall. That episode, by the way, it has to be said, if you haven't heard this episode of Trap One, please listen to it. I really enjoyed that episode. So this is, to give context, you and Mark. Mark was visiting your hometown, New York, and you talk through New York. Not only in terms of Mark's holiday, but also in terms of the Doctor Who references. And it was hugely entertaining. I really enjoyed that. So thoroughly recommended for everybody to listen to.
I had pitched to him the idea of doing a live episode during his visit, but he was not traveling alone and he thought that his wife would never stand for it. So the three of us had dinner together in Times Square, had a very lively conversation, and went to a bar afterwards, and we didn't talk much Doctor Who, so we did not do a live recording, but as soon as he got back to the UK, we did an episode remotely where we talked our way through his trip and through the various Doctor Who stories that take place here, from the chase all the way up through, I believe it was The Return of Doctor Mysterio. No, sorry, Nikola Tesla's Night of Terror would be the most recent in New York. So we talked through those stories in chronological order. The actual recording was almost 2 hours, and I was doing a lot more sub-Bowery Boys podcast anecdotes and stories about New York. During the edit, I got tired of hearing myself speak, so I cut out about 25 minutes worth of Jason tourist anecdotes that don't really fit into Doctor Who. So what's left is the best 80 minutes of that conversation, and I'm glad you enjoyed it.
It was really wonderful. So I thoroughly recommend that to everybody.
Thank you. And I recommend, of course, anybody listen to Conrad wherever and whenever they can. That is Trap One coming up. That is Trap One in the past. That is this podcast in the past. This podcast coming up. And, of course, Flight Through Entirety for their 50th anniversary week series.
Exciting times. Thank you so much for having me on again, Jason. I was saying to you before this... we recorded this, you know, it's been really nice to hear over that. It's just been a year, I think, you've been doing this, and it's been really nice to hear it going from strength to strength. I've thoroughly enjoyed the guests you've had on recently. I'm really enjoying listening to this, and I'm sure a lot of your audience feel the same too. So thank you so much.
Conrad, thank you very much for the kind words. Yes, I've been doing this now every week for 9 months, and I'm amazed that my numbers are actually going up rather than down. People are actually listening to this. So I'd like to thank everybody who has written into me or volunteered to be on the show or sent me great ideas. I got an email today from a past guest who is already planning their next appearance, which is 3 months from now. And you, of course, reached out to me about doing a reading, which we're going to play next. That's an incredible reading. So it's not – I have guests who are upping the game and challenging me and just bringing incredible stuff to this show. So couldn't do it without you guys.
But thank you so much for having me on. It's been a joy. Linx cancelled the inspection. It was pointless. The CV transmitter had suffered a massive rupture. The Rutan fighter pilot, he realised, had played for safety, firing a bracket cluster in the hope of crippling the cruiser rather than aiming for a direct hit. And, ironically, his own evasive manoeuvre had turned the cruiser into the periphery of a burst. Now, indeed, all hope had ended. The ship's speed was falling. It was only a matter of time, very little time, before the pursuing fighters overhauled him. All he could do now was to play the game to its finish. A small solar system showed directly ahead on the screens. The star chart identified it as Sol, a fourth magnitude star with 9 planets. There was no other data. The system had never been surveyed. Linx switched off the star chart. He had hoped for something bigger, but he would head for the system. Within an interplanetary atmosphere, spectronic flight was impossible. He might conceal for a little longer the extent to which the cruiser was damaged. He might even, if luck was with him, swing round the blind side of one of those tiny planets and get in a cannonade at his pursuers. It was worth trying. If he could destroy just one more Rutan ship, he would not be totally dishonoured in death. Sol was looming on the screens, its central mass obscured by the blazing incandescence of its gases. Linx felt the cruiser slowing still further as it ploughed into the ion stream surrounding the star. And a crazy idea occurred. The dancing mantle of solar eruptions that concealed Sol's core would conceal the cruiser if he could fly that close. For a brief time, for perhaps 20 seconds, his starship's image would disappear from the screens of the pursuit ships, and if, during that time, he escaped in the scout ship. Coldly, Linx calculated the risks. The little scout vessel, stored in the cruiser's underpod, was an inadequate ship. Its heat shields had not been devised to withstand solar temperatures. Its motors were comparatively puny too. They might not pull the ship clear of Sol's gravity. Then, finally, if he escaped from the sun and the Rutan fighters hurtling on after his abandoned cruiser, finally, he would still have to face the unguessable hazards of traversing the galaxy in a tiny craft intended only for shuttling between planets. But such journeys had been made before. Linx remembered sagas about the heroes of antiquity. They would have considered the little scout a superbly equipped ship. Already, the blazing face of Sol was engulfing the screens. If he was going to make the attempt, he would have to hurry. Swiftly, he programmed an orbital path above the star's surface. The cruiser's hull temperature was rising rapidly as he disconnected the recorders and carried them down to the scout ship. There was no time for pre-flight checks. Settling behind the single console of the control bridge, Linx reached immediately for the emergency firing pin. He barely heard the muffled explosion of the launching rocket that catapulted the little scout ship out into space. The G-pressure was like a giant hand crushing him into unconsciousness. Linx came round slowly. The rasping scream of the motors intruded first into his mind, warning that something was wrong, even before he forced his eyes open. Acrid yellow smoke was curling through the vent tubes into the control bridge. He sat up and peered at the display panels. 7 minutes elapsed flying time. Even though it was apparent the little scout had suffered some grievous damage, Linx felt a surge of relief. That length of EFT surely meant that his ruse had succeeded. The scout ship was clear of the sun,
and the Rutan fighters were already a million miles away in futile pursuit of the empty cruiser. After all he had been through, the problem of nursing a sick craft across the galaxy to Sontara seemed comparatively easy. But as the deck computer analysed the damage the ship had sustained, Linx began to see the impossibility of his task. The scout's main drive had burnt out. Its gravity plates had buckled in the heat of the sun, and the pressure of the G-forces had sheared both gyro-stabilisers. The computer went on to produce a list of smaller defects, but Linx gave it little attention. Unless he could repair the ship, he had no chance of ever seeing Sontara again. But to reach the main drive, the ship would have to be completely stripped down. That meant making a landfall somewhere, if there proved to be a remotely suitable planet in this miserable little solar system. With only 9 planets in the system, Linx knew that the chance of one of them possessing a suitably breathable atmosphere were 1,000,000 to 1. He had little hope as he focused the spectrograph on each in turn. And the third planet, the little blue one, showed a reading of 94 on the scale. Unbelievable luck! Linx gave a shout of delight and pointed the scout ship towards the planet. Now, he thought, if only the planet proved to be the home of some semi-intelligent species, and oxygen-rich planets often were, he could drum them into a labour force and be on his way back to Sontara within a matter of weeks. Sontarans rarely smiled, except at the death throes of an enemy. But as his damaged ship flashed towards the third planet, Commander Jingo Linx allowed himself the smallest of satisfied smiles.
Chapter 1, Irongron's Star. Quote, "This was an age in which the powers of evil were very real, when old crones sold their souls to the devil for sinister powers, and sinners were frequently hauled off to hell with a clap of thunder and a stink of sulfur. The men of Irongron's band had plenty of sin on their consciences. None of them was anxious to meet the evil one before time." End quote. Chapter 1 is, let's face it, hilarious. This is a faithful script-to-screen adaptation. The chapter is basically a word-for-word transcript of the dialogue of the first 2 proper scenes on TV. But it's also tremendously funny. Terrance throws in a ton of wry aspersions about the integrity of Irongron's business practices, the ferocity of his men, and the legitimacy of their stay in Irongron's castle. There's a ton of backstory. The kind of stuff that Terrance said, in the above quote from the David J. Howe book, that he dropped over time, though he certainly has not dropped them at this point in his career in mid-1978. There's a reference here to, quote, Merry England, M-E-R-R-I-E. There's a long explanation of how and why Irongron has a castle, and there's a killer last sentence. They didn't know it, but the Earth had just been taken over. Chapter 2, Linx's Bargain. Quote, "I shall need some equipment of my own, too, including the TARDIS." The Brigadier gave him a suspicious look. Since the Time Lords had now lifted their sentence of exile, the Doctor remained on Earth by choice, rather than necessity. But he disappeared more and more frequently these days, and the Brigadier couldn't help fearing that one day his old friend would vanish forever. This chapter adapts 3 scenes from Part 1. Well, 2.5 scenes. Notably, the last 2 full pages of the chapter narrate things that weren't on TV. The one scene, between the Doctor and the Brigadier, goes on for longer than on TV, setting up backstory, reminding us of the departure of Joe at the end of Green Death, the previous televised story, the novelization of which was nearly 3 years old when this one came out. And it's been 9 months since the publication of Doctor Who and the Mutants, our last novelization featuring Joe. We discussed that here with Denise Sutton in episode 35, which is one of our top 5 most popular episodes so far. Then there's a little over a full page of text, told from Linx's POV leading into the next scene, which is continued in Chapter 3, Sarah's Bluff. Sarah went back to her own tiny cubicle and resumed her unpacking. There was something strange about the doctor. She was sure of it. For one thing, he'd accepted her story far too readily. Perhaps he had good reason to avoid contact with the authorities. Perhaps he was a spy himself. The enemy might well have planted an inside man. Sarah decided not to go to bed after all. Instead, she would stay awake and keep an eye on the doctor. End quote. Here is our introduction, our proper introduction, to Sarah Jane Smith in this, her 12th novelization. That's out of 42, but it's her TV debut story. Terrance gives us insight into how she feels in a man's world, even though the doctor's very first impression of her is about her nice smile. When watching Time Warrior as part of my pilgrimage most recently, in mid-2021, as Conrad and I discussed before, I struggled a little with Pertwee and Liz Sladen not having terrific chemistry in their first scenes together. That's not a problem in the book, and Terrance does give her a good intro. He also gives Irongron a victory in this chapter, showing him coring an apple with his new musket, which didn't happen on TV. Chapter 4, Irongron's Captive. Hal yawned and stretched. "I've had my fill of war, my sweet. I followed Sir Edward to the Crusades, aye, and brought him back again when his fever laid him low." Mary looked sideways at him. "Oh, 'tis not that you're too timid, then?"
"Timid?" roared Hal.
He nodded to the longbow that leaned against the wall, not far from his hand. "Why, if you were a man, I'd put a quiverful of arrows through you. Since you're a wench, I'll take a kiss instead." He reached for Mary, who dodged him and ran away laughing. Hal caught her and kissed her soundly, just as Lady Eleanor appeared in the doorway. End quote.
Wow.
I mean, wow. Is this Terrance Dicks or a bodice ripper? And yes, Conrad and I independently arrived at that same expression. What do you think of Hal the Archer plunging his quiverful of arrows into Mary's willing flesh? This scene, of course, is not on television. As Conrad tells us, this was scripted but not filmed. There was no single set built within Television Center for the one scene of Sir Edward's kitchens. There is no forced James Bond-style near-sexual assault on TV. I think Terrance included in this book, because it was part of Holmes' original script and thankfully never filmed. There's no real reason in-universe for a young buck like Hal to not be away at the Crusades, so we do need to know why he is back in merry old England. And Hal could use a good introductory scene, so off went Terrence's imagination like a plunging arrow. Chapter 4 is full of Easter eggs like this one. There's also an outdoor scene, also not on TV, and as Conrad said, this was scripted but not filmed, where Sir Edward's squire Eric rides through the forest, bearing Edward's message and dreams of glory, only to be brought down by the oldest trap in the book, a simple stretch of rope between two trees. The other scenes in this chapter, the ones that do appear on TV, also go on for longer, with more dialogue. Terrance must have been as much in love with this story as Hal the Archer was with Mary the Serving Wench. Chapter 5. The Doctor Disappears. "I just bumped into Sir Matthew Dingle, the biophysicist. I told him I was on the same landing as Lavinia Smith, the virologist. And do you know what he said? He said she's in her late 60s, and in addition, she's in America." End quote. Sir Matthew Dingle, the biophysicist. Sounds impressive, right? Just last week, in episode 41, covering the Tomb of the Cybermen, we learned that, as per Jerry Davis, Edward Waterfield was close friends with Michael Faraday. Fresh off this discovery, I was excited to learn more about the estimable biophysicist Sir Matthew Dingle. Alas, I could find nothing. Now, in the TV episode, he's not Matthew, he's Maxwell, and of course is not identified as a biophysicist. So, what's the deal with this? I ask genuinely. Is this a name invented by Holmes? Why is it different on TV versus the book? Now, according to Google, there actually was a Maxwell Dingle. He was a police officer in the UK, who'd have been only 35 or 36 when the script was written, and thus unlikely to have been an old acquaintance of Holmes, who was about 47 at the time of writing. Now, of course, for me, the name Dingle brings to mind the 1961 Twilight Zone episode Mr. Dingle the Strong, starring Burgess Meredith as Mr. Luther Dingle, who, in the words of the late Rod Serling, was, quote, a vacuum cleaner salesman whose volume of business is roughly that of a valet at a hobo convention. Yes, yes, my Rod Serling impression needs work. Unlikely that Holmes was quoting Serling, though. It's a mystery. Please contact me if you have any more information on this Sir Dingle. Other than that, the most notable thing about Chapter 5 is that it inverts scene order from television, combining the two Doctor/Rubish scenes into one, and putting Irongron's interrogation of Eric the Squire first. On page 48, Rubish utters the line, "Some women can think almost as well as a man." I'm just going to leave that there. That line is not on TV, for obvious reasons. Chapter 6, A Shock for Sarah. The figure looked round the yard, as if making sure that it was alone, then raised his hands and lifted the helmet from its head. The face beneath was something out of a nightmare. The head was huge and round, emerging directly from the massive shoulders. The hairless skull was greenish-brown in color, the eyes small and red. The little nose was a pig-like snout, the mouth long and lipless. It was a face from one of Earth's dark legends, the face of a goblin or a troll. But the Doctor was a Time Lord, and to him, it meant something very different. He gave a little nod of satisfaction. Just as I suspected. A Sontaran! The Sontarans are, I believe, the last of the major Doctor Who villains to be introduced in the Target books. In publication order, we've already met Daleks, Cybermen, the Master, the Sea Devils and Silurians, and the Ice Warriors, all discussed in earlier episodes of this podcast. Now we get our first good look at Linx under the helmet on page 60, which is not counting a brief glimpse from the Robert Holmes material on page 9. But chapter 6 is mostly Sarah Jane's chapter. We actually see her inside the TARDIS. There was no console room built on set for this serial, and Terrance has her hide on a wardrobe, Narnia style, so soon after he used the chapter title The Last Battle in two consecutive books earlier in 1978. As I said in my outside-in essay on this story, the Time Warrior is notable for being told from the bad guy's point of view. And Sarah, in her debut outing, believes the Doctor to be a villain, and later on will actually capture him. So this chapter allows us to see the Doctor through Sarah's eyes. And again, as with Chapter 1, Chapter 6 is very, very funny. Chapter 7, Prisoner in the Past. She, Sarah, looked thoughtfully round the hall. It was filthy, dust and grime everywhere. It was furnished only with the long central table and a scattering of heavy, crudely made stools and chairs. The table was covered with well-used metal platters and tankards, the floor strewn with dirty rushes and littered with old bones. Sarah looked at her two captors, the massive bearded leader and his lanky, fair-haired henchman. Both wore rough, homespun clothing and leather topcoats studded with steel. They had swords and daggers in their belts. Their hair was long and dirty, their hands and faces grimy, and they gave off a reek of savagery like wild beasts in a zoo. Sarah made a last, desperate attempt to find some rational explanation. After lavishing a near record-setting 54 pages of text on the Part 1 material, that leaves Terrance just 84 pages to adapt the remaining three episodes, an average of 28 pages per, only a little more than half of what Part 1 got. This chapter takes up most of the very long scene set in Irongron's hall that opens Part 2, and Terrance condenses it into 7 economical pages. But that long description of Sarah, realizing that she's actually traveled in time, is quite a good one. Most of the rest of the scene is crackling dialogue between Sarah, Irongron, and Bloodaxe, a typically awesome Holmes double act, and Linx, and Terrance mostly leaves those words alone. Not much more embellishment is needed when you have dialogue like that. Chapter 8. The Robot Knight. It was the faithful Bloodaxe who came to his captain's aid. Snatching up the axe that had been intended for Hal, he leaped boldly forward and swung his axe in a whistling arc that knocked the Black Knight's head from his shoulders. The helmet rolled across the courtyard, and the headless figure reeled, changed direction, and staggered into a corner, and stood slashing wildly at the stone wall. Terrance, my man, is getting into it here. First is Hal the Archer's lusty pursuit of the fair maiden Mary, and now Bloodaxe, that was Irongron on TV, beheads Linx's robot knight in a very vivid and entertaining manner. In fact, I want to say that again. Quote, the helmet rolled across the courtyard and the headless figure reeled. Man, that would be fun to reenact as a kid on the playground. Chapter 9. Linx's Slaves. The doctor took a deep breath. Steel yourself, Professor. This is going to be a shock to you. You've been brought back to the Middle Ages. Rubish blinked. How very interesting. I've always believed that the possibility of time travel should never have been dismissed so arrogantly by Professor Crabshaw and his cronies. Professor Crabshaw. I've read this book at least 3 times before, and seen the TV story at least 12 times, if not twice that. And I don't recall hearing the name Crabshaw before. But this podcast is about a close reading of the books. So a close reading your pal Jason will give you. Turns out this apocryphal Holmes character, mentioned but never seen, may be an actual true-life fictional creation. Crabshaw is a major character in a 1934 sci-fi short story called The Day of the Dragon by Guy Endor. So unlike the Professor Dingle reference above, there really is a fictional Professor Crabshaw, and I am sure this reference by Holmes is not accidental. Guy Endor, by the way, is really named Samuel Goldstein, and he was born in Brooklyn, New York. Frustratingly, Mr. Goldstein's Wikipedia page doesn't say where in Brooklyn. We are a huge borough here, in Brooklyn, and divided up into many neighborhoods, each with their own distinct character and identity. In 1901, I had one grandfather living on Delancey Street, on the Lower East Side of Manhattan, right around the corner from Sam Jaffe of Lost Horizon and Ben Casey fame. My other grandfather didn't arrive in the U.S. until 03, and my grandmothers hadn't been born yet. But all 4 of them eventually wound up in Brooklyn, across 3 different neighborhoods. I know my younger grandmother lived on the same street as Isaac Asimov some years later, but I have no idea about Guy Endor's Brooklyn roots. Anyone else know? Please reach out to me. I'm desperately curious. Chapter 10. Irongron's Wizard. As always, when faced with a difficult decision, Sir Edward turned to his wife. It is a bold plan, Edward, she said gently, and this is a time for boldness. It's an interesting fact, as Conrad and I discussed earlier, that all 3 of John Pertwee's companions were introduced in stories written by Robert Holmes. Sarah Jane and Liz Shaw got off to crackling starts. Joe Grant, not so much. Terrance, who would have co-created Sarah Jane, did a good job on DVD making of featurettes and audio commentaries of acting befuddled about what was then called women's lib, but I strongly suspect that he was much more in tune with it and in favor of it than he let on. The above quote, for example. That is not how the exchange happens on TV. On TV, Lady Eleanor has only 4 lines in the scene, and all at the beginning. On TV, Edward doesn't look to his wife. Edward himself says that the plan is bold, and you can't even see Eleanor's face, just the back of her hat and veil. Terrance shifts the true power behind Sir Edward's throne to the Lady Eleanor, as it should be. Chapter 11. The Rescue. Yawning, after what felt like far too little sleep, Sarah made her way up the winding staircase to the little tower room that the doctor had taken over for his laboratory. She found the doctor stirring an evil-smelling powder in an enormous wooden bowl. He was wide awake and infuriatingly cheerful. Perhaps he didn't need sleep, thought Sarah. This is an important chapter, as it's the moment where Sarah goes from unwanted stowaway to the Doctor's companion. Earlier in this recording, I commented upon my relative disappointment in the chemistry between Pertwee and Liz Sladen, but those concerns disappear, starting with this scene, which is wonderfully written and performed. Let's listen to a clip.
Here's a few more for you, Doctor.
Thank you, Sarah.
Lady Eleanor's got every serving wench in the castle sewing away like mad.
I told you there'd be plenty of work for everybody, didn't I?
Oh, typically masculine arrangement, though. We do all the dirty work, you get all the fun.
You don't think mixing the singularly noxious compound is fun, do you? How's the rest of it going?
Not bad. I put Sir Edward in charge of painting the dummies' faces, and he's turned out to be quite an artist. Once I'd set him on the right lines...
Excellent. I'm glad I decided to let you stay.
You decided.
You know, I was never much of a hand with a paintbrush myself.
No?
No. Nor a palette knife, for that matter. But I'd like to study under one of the masters one day. Rembrandt, preferably.
Rembrandt?
Mm-hmm.
Can you just go anywhere you like in that TARDIS?
Yes, within reason.
Then why are you staying here? Why didn't you go somewhere safer?
Because, my dear Sarah, I've got a job to do. One that involves the whole future of your species. Here, hold this, will you?
My species?
Mm-hmm.
You're talking as if you weren't human.
Yes, well, the definition of the word humanity was always rather a complex question, wasn't it?
You know perfectly well what I mean. Are you or aren't you?
If you mean, am I a native of the planet Terra, the answer is no, I'm not.
Well, what are you, then?
Me? I'm a Time Lord.
A Time Lord?
Yeah, that's right. And my people are very keen to stamp out unlicensed time travel. You can look upon them as galactic ticket inspectors, if you like.
Galactic ticket inspectors?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I could murder a cup of tea. You're serious, aren't you?
About what I do, yes. Not necessarily the way I do it.
There are several other scenes in Chapter 11. The Doctor charming Sir Edward and Lady Eleanor, Irongron running off an incredible string of insults, Terrance changes a long, shank rascal to long, shanked knave. And that's a deep literary cut, with rascal typically having a more affectionate connotation, and knave being the sharper insult. Terrance also, as Conrad told us earlier, cuts out a fairly sexist Holmes scripted line when Sarah tells Edward that she misjudged the Doctor. Holmes has Pertwee say, "That's a generous admission, especially coming from one of the fair sex." But Terrance cuts that right out of the book. Right out. Thankfully. Chapter 12. The Doctor's Magic. Linx turned away.
"Threaten me once more," he said casually, "then I shall destroy you."
Goaded beyond endurance, Irongron raised his sword, and Linx's arm swept out and swatted him almost carelessly away. The result was extraordinary. Irongron's massive figure flew backwards across the hall, went head over heels across the banqueting table, smashed into the wall beyond, and slid slowly to the ground. Now that's a stunt. Is that how it happened on TV? To quote Julia Stiles in 10 Things I Hate About You, not even close, not even a little bit, not even at all. On TV, Kevin Lindsay pushes David Dacre against a table. But in the books, Terrance can use his imagination like this. This chapter also effectively, and amusingly, describes Irongron's failed assault on Sir Edward's castle. But, writing primarily from the TV scripts, Terrance loses one nice moment. The Doctor's line in the book, at the end of the chapter, about having another idea, is more fairly given to Sarah Jane on TV, more in keeping with her character. Finally, in terms of alterations, Terrance makes the decision to spare the life of Squire Eric, who lies in the dungeon in the book, but died in the dungeon on TV. And later on, page 136, Terrance remembers to go back and free Eric from the dungeon before, spoiler alert, Irongron's castle blows up. The net effect, Eric, dead on TV, very much alive in the book. Chapter 13, Counterattack. Huddled in their borrowed cloaks, the two wandering friars trudged back towards their monastery in some confusion. They were grateful for Sir Edward's handsome donation, but what was the abbot going to say about their missing robes? Terrance adds one scene to this otherwise faithful chapter. There's the bit on TV where the Doctor and Sarah cosplay as friars to get into Irongron's castle, while the two guards have a bit of fun at their expense. Let us hope the good friars are fleet of foot, or there will soon be two new martyrs in heaven, is Terrance's version of the equally funny TV line. For the book, Terrance adds a brief cutaway to the two monks from whom the Doctor and Sarah got their brown robes. A cutaway scene like that wouldn't fit on television, but it's an additional sight gag for what's already a genuinely funny novelization. Chapter 14, The Robot's Return. From where she stood, Sarah could see a small circular hole at the back of Linx's spacesuit, where the nape of the neck would have been on a human being. She wondered why the Doctor was telling Linx something he already knew. Then she realized the Doctor wasn't telling Linx at all. He was telling Rubish. The old man had armed himself with a metal bar, and he was creeping slowly up behind the Sontaran. With aggravating slowness, Rubish took out his homemade spectacles and peered through them, assuring himself of his target. We haven't talked much about Rubish yet. He's a character with only the barest of plot utility, giving the Doctor someone to explain the plot to, while the Brigadier's only in two scenes, and while Sarah's off leading her own army. But the character of Rubish does provide comic relief, until this scene where he becomes something of an unexpected action hero. Now, this was made in 1973. Here we are, and as recently as 2021 and the Flux season, a blow to the back of the neck is still the only way to defeat a Sontaran. This chapter also omits one brief scene between Irongron and Bloodaxe, one of the few TV scenes left out of the book. Chapter 15, Shooting Gallery. Linx's eyes flickered open, and his face twisted with rage as he realized his position. He began struggling furiously. Irongron drew his sword. He looked thoughtfully at the helpless Sontaran for a moment, then decided he still needed him. He sawed through the plastic flecks with his sword. That's really interesting, and really dark. I've never noticed that moment of hesitation before. That's Irongron giving serious thought to killing Linx while the latter is powerless. That is not indicated anywhere in David Dacre's and Kevin Lindsay's performances on TV, where Dacre cuts Linx loose as soon as he finds him. The alliance between Linx and Irongron is one of my favorite parts of the story. Linx seems to have a genuine fondness for Irongron, at times, and gives him fair warning when he's about to leave, thereby destroying the castle. Linx is even philosophical when Irongron refuses to listen. Let's listen.
For the last time, Linx, let there be no more talk of leaving.
And I tell you for the last time, I am leaving now. Our alliance is at an end.
It ends when I say it ends, and not before.
You would be well advised to march from this castle now and capture another. Soon you will have need of it.
Friendless captain.
He does not understand our ways. Tomorrow, Linx, we smite the enemy, hip and thigh. But tonight, we feast.
By your dawn, I shall be 700 million miles from here. Can I be concerned with the fate of primitives?
That is not how many invading aliens / cooperating human alliances go in Doctor Who. Yes, Linx does kill Irongron in the end, primarily in self-defense. But up until then, he more than honored their agreement. Watching those two interact is one of the highlights of the story for me. Terrance adds this brief beat, where Irongron has the premonition that he needs to kill Linx first. Irongron almost does it, but does not. Chapter 16, Return to Danger. Sarah checked her run as the two pikemen came forward to bar their way. Leave them to me, Sarah, yelled the Doctor. Just keep running. Sarah saw the first pikeman lunge. The Doctor dodged, and suddenly the pikeman sailed through the air, landing with a crash that knocked him cold. Sarah ran for the gate, and the second pikeman ran out. The Doctor grabbed him, twisted and threw, sending the man flying after his fellow. By the time Irongron and the others reached the yard, the dazed sentries were picking themselves up, and the Doctor and Sarah had disappeared into the forest. That's a great action sequence, and again, far more elaborate than we got on TV. Between that and Eric the Squire being saved from death in a short added scene exclusive to the book, you get a real sense in this chapter of how Terrance takes the time, even during a jam-packed climax, in a short chapter spanning 10, count them, 10 scenes, to fix one minor character's fate and to jazz up a good fight scene. Chapter 17, Linx's departure. As Linx went to pick up his ray gun from beneath the bench, Sarah threw herself upon him, but he brushed her casually away. She flew across the room, slammed into a column, and fell. Yikes. Not on TV, she didn't. Chapter 17 is a very short climax. Not like Hal and his girlfriend in Chapter 4, if you get what I mean. It's only 6 pages, but Terrance includes more violent action than we saw on TV, where John Pertwee got all the stunts, including this pretty unfortunate moment of Linx physically hitting Sarah Jane so hard that she goes airborne. The scenes in the chapter are also in somewhat different order to on TV, Rubish getting sent home, and Irongron waking up in that order in the book, but in reverse order on TV. But you would be hard-pressed to beat some of Terrance's last sentences. Of the slain Santaran, Terrance writes, "Commander Linx was going back to his war at last." And the final paragraph narrates things nicely from Hal the Archer's point of view. Hal watched, quite unsurprised, as the blue box faded away with a wheezing, groaning noise. How else should a wizard depart? He turned and looked behind him. The fiery red glow from the blazing ruins of Irongron's castle was lighting up the night sky. Hal turned away and began his journey home. I defy you to write a better closing paragraph than that one. Next time on Doctor Who Literature, we move forward a month, and it's now July 1978, more than 5 years after The Time Warrior went before the cameras. But we're still on a Terrance Dicks run, and we're still reading adaptations of stories televised during season 11. This next story has everything. Cliffhangers about interior decorating, tootling saxophones, dozens of Terry Nation script cliches, space plague, malfunctioning TARDIS, evil Scotsman, and Daleks without the power to kill. It's the novelization of Death to the Daleks next time. Thank you for joining me on another episode of Doctor Who Literature. I'm Jason, your host and editor and producer. Special thanks to my special guest, Conrad Westmaas. And let's everyone take a moment and thank Conrad for that amazing guest reading. This podcast can be found on most of your podcast apps of choice. You can find all past episodes at anchor.fm/Doctor Who Lit. It really helps if you rate 5 stars and subscribe. You can find me on Twitter at Doctor Who Novels, that's Dr. Who Novels, and under the hashtag Doctor Who Pilgrimage, that's Dr. Who Pilgrimage, and on email at Doctor Who Literature, that's drwholiterature@gmail.com. Please drop me a line with your comments, questions, and suggestions. Thank you for listening, and whatever you do, keep turning the pages. Thank you.